so happy to welcome you, Mr. Garrett Morris.
Tracy, lovely lady. May I give you a hug, please? Thank you for the invitation.
Of course, of course.
Right, yes.
You are among many of the Tracys. I know Tracy Chapman.
I like, she drives a fast car. Did you know that?
Yeah. All right.
My feelings, a connection.
Are you from New Orleans?
I wish I was. I'm from Kentucky.
You look like you got connections there.
So speaking of New Orleans.
Yes.
This is where you were born and raised.
Born and raised. Can I say the date? Yes. When the earth was flat.
What year was
that? Yes, 1937, February the 1st. And I have to say probably it was raining because my favorite, okay, thing about the weather in general is what happens to New Orleans all the time. You'll have it sunny at 9, you'll have it raining at 12, you'll have it sunny at 3, you'll have it I like that kind of weather.
Why? That terrifies me.
If I go to 10, 12 months without rain, that's somehow good. There's a song even called It Never Rains in California. Why is that a good thing?
Tony.
Yeah. So I like a little drizzle every once in a while. Anyway,
okay.
My grandfather and my grandmother raised me, Thomas Phillips and Gertrude Phillips. And my grandfather, you know, my grandfather was Louisiana's greatest minister, I would say. When he died, about 100 ministers came to his funeral.
Wow.
Celebrated him. New Orleans funerals are long anyway. You can imagine.
Yeah.
You could have gone home and slept. You know, did ever come back to
take a nap, they right, still
right.
out there.
But he was, he used to speak, one of them whooping preachers, right?
And he spit, Sunday morning.
And he spit when he spoke. So if you're sitting within the 2 or 3 yards, you got hit with some spit. Now, you got filled with the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
But you got hit with the Holy Spit. Hello, hello. And with him, though, I blame him. I credit him with what's going on with me now because I see my career as emulating him. And here's what I mean. When I was about 3.5 years old, according to the people, I was reading the Bible. Now, I didn't understand a goddamn thing I was reading. Let's get that straight.
Of course.
Okay. My grandfather, during the week, he was writing his sermon. That's writing. On the weekend, he preached. That's acting. He was also a singer, right? So he sang and he directed the choir. And he was a composer. One of his songs is right now in the regular song things back down south, right? So what am I? I'm an actor, singer, writer, composer. Right.
Okay.
So I, and then when I came to New York City, my first job was as a singer arranger with Harry Belafonte.
So
my,
can you sing a little bit for me so I can see if
Dala,
I know it?
Party, la, dee, 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 da, 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 da. But I mean, it wasn't nothing. Da, da, da.
This is the most delightful thing I've ever experienced. And I think this is so amazing because I feel like people don't think about Black people. Especially like quote unquote normal Black people, you know, people don't associate us with like high art and classic and classical music like that.
Yeah.
So
I was born in New Orleans where you have a mixture of that from the beginning, right? So
yes,
I never
sure.
really even saw music as being separated like that until I started studying it.
And you studied it at an HBCU, Dillard University.
Dillard University, right? Greatest time of my life, one of the greatest times of my life to be on that campus. There I met some great teachers. David Budoff, Miss Marilyn Coleman.
I love that you can remember their names. See, yeah, I went to the very opposite of an HBCU.
Okay.
I went to a tiny school, tiny white school in Kentucky that nobody's heard of.
You were among all the white people, and you survived.
Somehow.
Oh,
what a grace of God.
Yes.
Oh, I did it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Woo. Thank you.
Yes. If your parents sent you there with a certain positive attitude towards what you're going to learn, I think that's correct, okay? You're in America where you're going to be among a whole lot of Black people at one time and be the only Black person in a group. So you got that experience.
Absolutely.
Here's what I'm saying. The one thing that's wrong with it is that as a kid, I didn't know that every high school had Black in it. One of the things about segregation was that all Black schools knew not only about George Washington, they knew about George Washington Carver. They not only knew about the white geniuses, they knew about the Black geniuses as well.
Black Wall Street.
Not only did I know about Robert Frost, I knew about Phyllis Wheatley. Paul Lawrence Dunbar. Right?
Black legends, if
right,
you will.
Right. So I'm not only learning about white in general, I'm learning about Black and in between in those Black venues. So I do hope that the Black colleges not necessarily get less white, mm-hmm. but at least keep in their history and what they study at those colleges.
Right.
All people, be they white or black, study the black part of how they got there as mm-hmm. well.
So I work in an industry where almost everybody is like 21. There are a lot of people who don't get my cultural references. Mm-hmm. So, to one of these poor souls who has no idea, how would you describe your character Stan on Martin?
Well, I thought it was like slimy, jive-ass player.
Okay.
Well, he's a small businessman who made it big.
Do you know how I would describe?
How would you describe?
I would describe him as a cat daddy. Are you familiar with that
daddy?
Term?
Yes, I'm familiar with that term.
Mm, really? So for the way that I define a cat daddy is like he's got on a suit at 2 o'clock in the afternoon on a Tuesday.
Men not fitting?
Yeah, not at all.
Could be tight. Could
Some
be not
form
be
of hat. Can go.
Yes.
Could be a what do you call them, a fedora?
Yes.
Their favorite pickup line, which I think it just hits my heart every time. You know, you're walking down the street, and they'll say, hey, mama, how you doing? And you'll be like, oh, I'm fine. And then they say, well, I can see you fine, but I asked you how you doing.
Oh, my God.
Have you ever said that to a woman?
Oh, my God.
Tell the truth. Don't act like this is the first time you heard it. You said that before, haven't you?
Oh, my God.
Taking that as a yes and moving to the next question.
Get out of my face.
So as I was saying earlier,
mm-hmm.
I feel like most of the young black people that I know
mm-hmm.
are team Jamie Foxx show. And the others, like me,
mm-hmm.
are team Martin.
Okay.
You are the only person that can settle this debate, having worked on both shows.
Oh, God.
Which is the better show?
Oh, God.
Which one was the most
funny? See, this would make me now settle an argument that I wasn't even involved in.
Well,
okay.
Just help me out. No. I need to be like Garrett Morris said.
Who, if I say Jamie Foxx, then, they're both comedians. I think geniuses. Is very singly into his comedy thing.
Who is?
One is very rooted only in comedy.
But only one of those two.
Huh?
Only one of those two fired you when you were in the hospital, though.
See, I'm trying to be objective.
I feel like that's, okay, you know
Tracy,
what? That's fine. But
I'm trying to be objective, okay?
You're right.
And I'm trying, I'm dealing. So,
mm-hmm.
He did. But, people are going to think that he's prejudiced. Or as my grandmother used to say, he's prejudicy. That's what she pronounced the word.
Prejudicy.
She said, Garrett, white people are prejudicy.
Oh.
I said,
prejudicy.
I said, do you mean prejudice? Yeah, that's what I said. They're prejudicy. You know? I thought they both had, you know, some things to recommend them. I had a lot of fun on Jamie's show.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I'm not going to tell anybody that you said that.
Y'all keep it a secret, okay?
Don't tell nobody.
Don't tell nobody, okay? Yeah.